Chidagni kunda sambhuta deva karya samuddhata. When your resolution is noble, when your desire to have her is exclusive, you will not be disappointed. Udyat banu sahasrava chatur bahur samanvita. Udyat banu sahasrava, like thousand suns, the radiance. Udyat banu sahasrava chatur bahur samanvita. Ma has four limbs, four arms. They are dharma, artha, kama, moksha. They are the four pursharthas. Dharma, artha, kama, moksha. They are the four types of sound. Madhyama, vaikhari, pashanti, para. They are the four types of japa. Vachik, upanshu, mansik, ajapa. They are the four types of avastha. Sushupta, jagrit, swapan, turiya. They are the four types of guna. Sattva, rajas, tamas, gunatit. So the form of ma starts with these most basic and most fundamental attributes that are the very basis of existence of every single living entity on our planet and beyond. Rags rupa pashadha, krodha kara ankushajjwala. She's holding a noose of passion. And the goad is of anger. Mano rupekshu kodanda. The bow she is holding is of mind. Panch tanmatra sayaka. The five arrows she is holding are the five tanmatras or the subtle elements, also known as shabd, sparsh, ras, roop, gandh. Touch, taste, smell, sight, and sound. So she's holding that. And if you look at it from the perspective of sadhana, these are your only hurdles anyway. These are your only obstacles on the path of sadhana. Rising above your passion, whether that's passion to accomplish something or passion to do something, rising above your desires and rising above your anger. This is where this will be always a first test of any sincere seeker. Now, the nature does not want to put you through tests intentionally. It just happens so. It's all automatic. If you churn milk and you produce butter, you will end up with some buttermilk as well. Residue is the fundamental law of nature. As you progress on the path of sadhana, you move from the form to the formless. Antarmukh samaradhya bahirmukh sudurlabha. She's much easier to attain when you worship her within you. Because then she becomes part of every single atom of your existence, which are trillions in number. The magnitude just builds to a level where you start to feel her presence. And if you want to utilize divine energy to do anything in life, you need to be able to tap into it. To be able to tap into the divine energy, you need to be able to feel it. If I need to plug this microphone, I need to know where to go. I need to bring the two things together. Then alone, I can say it. So it is not without reason that Sahasranama starts with the physical attributes of Mother Divine. And then you move to the formless attributes. And in fact, in the morning discourse today, which was elsewhere, I spoke on chakras, and it was all based on Lalitha Sahasranam. And the primary shlokas, starts with Muladhar Ek Nilya Brahma Granthi Vibhedani Manipurantarudita Vishnu Granthi Vibhedani Agya Chakrantra Lasta Rudra Granthi Vibhedani Sahasara Muja Ruda Sudha Sahara Vivarshani Tradilata Samruji Shat Chakro Pari Sanstita Mahasakti Kundini Bistantutaniyasi. Then you rise above the three knots, Brahma Granthi, Vishnu Granthi, and Rudra Granthi. And they are the knots of desire, of sustenance or of clinging, and of destruction respectively. People want to create, that's Brahma knot, knot of Brahma. You want to create something, you want to build wealth, build houses, build things, build name, and so on and so forth. That's the first primary desire which is hard to overcome. And then second is to somehow retain, preserve all that you have. That's Vishnu Granthi. And the third is Rudra Granthi, which is destruction, destructive thoughts, and thoughts of self-doubt, thoughts of hatred, thoughts of anger, thoughts of jealousy, thoughts of envy. These are all destructive thoughts. Even very, very good sadhakas, extremely good seekers, can fall prey to destructive thoughts. Happens all the time. Our scriptures are replete with such stories. So once you move from form to the formless, and you start to, basically when you learn to combine both aspects of worship, then you are ready for the divine grace. This will mark the end of the beginning of your sadhana. I really want to stress on this. I'm talking about Lalitha Sahasranam from the perspective of not just chanting, that most of you know anyway. I'm talking how to get results from Sahasranam. Savyapsavya margastha sarvabhvi nivarani swastha svaha madura dhira dhir smarchita. Savya apsavya. Savya is the left-handed path of Tantra. Apsavya is the right-handed path of Tantra. Savya is everything that is taboo. Apsavya is everything that is acceptable. Savya is everything that is forbidden. Apsavya is everything that is normal. So to really have her complete understanding, so that you can start to experience your own divine nature, you really have to be at ease with all good and bad that is around you. This definition, this conditioning of this is good, this is bad, this is right, this is wrong, you will have to rise above it if you are really serious about having her. And what I'm going to tell you now is very, very hard for most people to do. Almost impossible. The first thing you have to realize, you have to stop discriminating between people from one type to the other. As long as you're discriminating, you're not seeing her in everybody. And until you do that, there is no real hope. You may get a dream, you may get a pseudo vision, but you will remain the person you are. So no matter who walks through the door, you should be able to see, or at least try to see divine, Mother Divine in it. Everybody has some good parts. Everybody has some good offering. You only have to look at that. I am not asking you become artificial. But if somebody touches your cloth just because you are going to the puja graha, and you think you are some, descended from the heaven, and know if anybody touches you, it's all dirty. You will have to rise above it if you are serious. If you're happy chanting, well, then I have no, it's your call. If you're just happy chanting like a parrot and that gives you joy, well, that's fine too. Whatever makes you happy, really. Whatever makes you happy is okay, but whatever makes you compassionate is better. Whatever makes you divine is even better. whatever makes you, you, is the best. To get in touch with you, who you really are, the source. So the greatest offering you can make to Mother Divine, which is bound to bring results, do you know what it is? Chaitanya Arga Samaradhya Chaitanya Kusma Priya Sadodita Sadatushta Taruna Aditya Patla Chaitanya Arga Samaradhya. The greatest offering you can make is the offering of the consciousness. What does it mean? It means to always be aware of her presence in our lives. Sadodita, Sadodita, always being aware, awake, conscious of what I'm saying, what am I thinking, how am I behaving, are my words helping the other person or destroying them. Sadatushta, always contented. Always, always contented. Atma nev atmana tushta stit pragyasta tuchyate, says Krishna. Shri Bhagavan Uvach, those who are stit pragya Arjun, O Kantai, they live in their soul, and that's where they roam around. There is no need for any external mechanism at that point in time. When you learn to ride a bike as a child with the supporting wheels, there comes a time when you take them off. You don't just ride your whole life with the supporting wheels. So if you are serious about any proximity to Mother Divine, somewhere along the line, you will have to rise above everything you've been doing till date. What matters is how sincere you are. When you practice some concentration, some contemplation, some reflection, and some purity in your life, you become ready to receive the grace. You will only experience grace if you're ready for it. If you're sitting in a closed room, no sunlight. Sun is there. Some are basking in sunlight. But you're not experiencing it. You're not feeling it. So those curtains need to be lifted. And the only real sadhana in the world for any deity, for any objective, for anything remotely close to spirituality is the path of self-purification. If you continue to purify yourself, you will continue to elevate. And then you will rise to a level where you can look at the whole world and make sense of everything that is happening around you. So the third part is initiation. If you are looking at Lalitha Sahasranam from the perspective of sadhana, it will really help the cause if you are initiated in it. Those of you who are from the Sri Vidya tradition or even generally would perhaps must have heard of Sandarya Lahiri, right? Sandarya Lahiri was written by Adi Guru Shankaracharya. It is a eulogy to Mother Divine. So there was a seeker once. Each verse in Sandarya Lahiri offers basically an independent application, an independent tantric application. So he took a mantra, took a shlok, took a verse from that and started chanting it. So the rule was to chant it 31,000 times as per the book, as per the scripture. He chanted but didn't get the results. And he thought, my chanting wasn't good enough. So he did another anushtan, also called pursharthas, and he did it for 62,500 times. Still didn't get the results. Then he got really frustrated. And then he took it again, took it up again, and chanted 1.25 lakh times. Still no results at all. And he thought, these scriptures, the things mentioned in these scriptures, don't apply to the times of today. A month later, he had a meeting with his guru. He His guru said to him, do you have Sundari Lehri with you? He said, yes, or can you bring it to me? He brought Sundari Lehri to his guru. His guru opened a page, pointed that verse, and said, now go, chant it every day for the next 40 days. And he thought, 40 days? The book had said something like 11 days or 20 days. And he said, how many times do I chant it? He said, just one round. 108 times. He said, just one round? He said, okay, you can do 10 rounds then. He originally said, Guru said 13 times. It's a true story, so I have to give you the fact. The Guru said, chant only 13 times. He said, only 13 times? That's too less. He said, okay, you can do one full round, one mala. Just 108 times, he said. The Guru said, all right, you do 10 times then, 10 rounds. And then he realized, I must shut up. Because with my questions, my Guru is bumping up the count. You see, there are only two types of conversations that occur between a guru and a disciple. A third type of conversation is not possible. A, guru asks a question and you answer. B, you ask a question and guru may answer. There is no room for discussion or argument. There is no room for answer on top of an answer. So his guru said, do it, do 10 rounds in a day. I said, well, I should shut up. My guru's not liking it, perhaps. He goes away. He starts the pursharthas, anushtan. And lo and behold, surely the result came exactly as the scripture had mentioned it. And he goes running to his guru, thinking his guru will be so proud of him. Because he must have done it right. And he says to his guru, thank you, I got the results. And he prostrated and all those things. And the guru didn't give any blessings. And the guru maintained a straight face. And this really bothered him. He said, why are you upset with me? What's wrong? I thought you'd be very happy. I finished my sadhana. The guru said, yes, you did. But you don't know how much damage you have done to everybody else in the lineage who will be here in the future. The guru said, my guru had simplified the whole sadhana with the power of his penance so that nobody will need to do it 31,000 times or 1.5 lakh times, 1.25 lakh times, they would only need to do 13 times every day and that's it. But now, with you in the lineage, you have unnecessarily reset the clock, reset the counter, and now everybody after you must do 10 rounds a day to get the results. So this is the importance of initiation. Because when you're initiated, they will tell you this is what worked for them. And you become part of a family of the lineage and they do protect you and guide you as well. When you do your sadhana with devotion, meditating correctly with, comfort and passion, and you're initiated as well, please know this, initiation is not a showstopper though. It helps, but it's not a showstopper. You will get initiation somewhere, or you will get divine guidance directly if you persist with devotion and meditation on the form. But when you have all three in place, the fourth element comes into picture. And then suddenly, you see the whole puzzle. Complete. Till then, it's fragmented, it's broken, it's hard to make sense. So what is the fourth element? I'd like to tell you a little story. There was a boy who was 7 years old. He's picked up by a saint. And the saint says, I'll take you with me to my cave and I will train you in the worship of Mother Divine. The boy's parents agreed. The boy went with the master. And the boy was bright, he was 7 years old. He said to his master, how long will it take me to get that transcendental experience of samadhi? The guru said, it will take you 12 years. He said, okay, I'll do whatever you tell me for 12 years. One by one, 12 years go by, no samadhi. 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. 17 years go by, no samadhi, no tranquil equipoise, no meditational state. And one day he says to his guru, I'm now going to the Ganges. Guru said, why? At this time? He said, yes, I'm going to drown myself now. He said, oh, okay. Well, make sure you tie a big rock with you, so in case your mood changes, you can't just float up. And he says, all right, that's what I'm doing. And he's about to leave, and Guru says, come here. Why are you so agitated? What's wrong? He said, you promised me samadhi 17 years ago. You said it would take 12 years, but 5 more years have gone since then, and I'm still without samadhi. What's this? You made a false promise. And Guru said, all right, sit down. He sits down. All right, chant the mantra after me, Guru says. He does it. And the Guru touches him. As soon as the Guru touches him, very like calm sensations start to dawn on his whole body, as if a million darts of bliss pierced his very existence. And he feels amazing. He goes in samadhi for a few minutes. A few minutes later, he comes out. And he said, well, that was all good and great, but I have a question now. The Guru said, what's the question? What question could you possibly have now? I've given you samadhi. He said, well, was it your touch or my sadhana? What got the result? Your touch or my sadhana? If it was my sadhana, why did you need to touch me? And if it was your touch or your sadhana, then why on earth you took 17 years? You could have given me this experience 17 years ago. And I would have believed you. I would have become a better sadhak. I would have believed all these things actually exist. I would have persisted on the path with much more vigor and fervor. The Guru said, you are silly. You were silly. And you will always remain silly. You see, it was neither your touch, it was neither my touch, nor your sadhana. It was not your sadhana, and it wasn't my sadhana, it wasn't my touch. It was divine grace. But after 17 years of practice, you were ready to receive the grace. Tesham satyuktanam bhajatam pridipurvakam dadami buddhi yogam tam yena mam apyantite. Those who worship me with utmost devotion, O Kante. It's okay, it's okay. To such a person, I give them wisdom. They are able to differentiate right from wrong. Tesham evanukam partham hamak gyanajam tamah. Nasham atma bhavasto gyanadipen bhaswata. And then doing special favors for them. My special grace, I firmly situate myself in their very being and light the lamp of knowledge. But of course, before all this happens, he says, Tesham satati yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam. You have to be ready for the grace. A beggar can never become a king by begging. What you're asking for is the ultimate treasure. You can't have it by begging. You have to become a recipient. If you go outside a car showroom and you see a beggar, he may beg till the cows come home. He may beg for the rest of his life, please give me a car, please give me a car. He won't even get a cup of tea. When you walk in, you know, with some chips in your pocket, and they will give you the car, and they will give you a cup of tea, and they will also congratulate you, and they will also call you sir or ma'am. Why? Because you're a recipient. They don't have to like you, but you're a customer. You are a worthy recipient. This is the primary difference between a beggar and a bhakta, bhikhari and a bhakta. A beggar says, I'm not interested in you, just give me what you can do for me. Just give me what you have. If you see a beggar on the street, if you tell that beggar, come work for me, I'll give you employment, say no thanks, just give me 10 rupees. But a bhakta says, I don't want what you can give me. I want you. And you tell me, what do I have to do to have you? And this is the primary difference. So, devotion, meditation, initiation, and then grace is bound to come. There are no two ways about it. And you can do Sahasranam as a sadhana, and that's how it works. There was a man, he was walking alone at night, and from a distance, he sees some people on horses. And he sees these horsemen coming towards him, and he gets afraid. He thinks they are the robbers, and it starts to run away. But the horsemen were in fact his friends. And they see his friend, their friend running. They think, what's wrong with him? And they start to run after him. And he goes, jumps across, and hides behind a tree. And these four or five folks, you know, dismount and also go close to him and say, what are you doing here? Why were you running away from us? And he realized, oh, these are my friends. He said, well, it's a bit complicated. You are here because of me, and I'm here because of you, he said. Mother Divine is here because of you, and you are here because of Mother Divine. Now, sometimes the colors of the nature are not pleasant, and we start to run away from them. Somehow we want to avoid them, but they ultimately are our friends. If we truly believe we are a child, or we are children, or I'm a child of Mother Divine, then you tell me, where is the room for any fear? Where is the room for any fear? Anything at all? From starvation, deprivation, to death. If everything is her creation, what do I have to fear? But that doesn't mean I can just renounce my karma. Doesn't mean I stop doing what I'm supposed to do and just keep saying, well, you please make it happen, please make it happen. You know, you've got to buy the lottery ticket to win a lottery, right? For to buy that ticket, you've got to have some money in your pocket. So if you are sincere in your sadhana and you're not fooling yourself, I meet people all the time who tell me, I chant this, I chant this, I've read this scripture, I've read that scripture, and I say, this is your core problem. That's why you have restricted yourself greatly from experiencing the truth, because you think you've got it figured out. She doesn't live in books. If she could, everybody would have her. Everybody has her, in fact. It's only a matter of realizing that truth.